there, folks. Jeremy from the Seeds of Liberty podcast here again with another installment of Abolitionist Abstractions. As always, Abolitionist Abstractions is covered by the BIPCOT no-gov license. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about that at BIPCOT.org. So today, I want to do something a little bit different. Up until this point, I've been talking a lot about what government does wrong, or what the supporters of government do that is wrong. We also do a lot of that on the Seeds of Liberty, and you know, it's quite common among people in our circles to talk negatively about the state and the effects that it wreaks on the rest of us. But one of the common objections people like myself get when engaging with others that do not see the state in the same way that I and others do is that all you do is complain and there's no solutions and you're not presenting anything. Well, the simple answer to that is there isn't necessarily a solution to give, because no one can know with any reasonable amount of certainty what can and will occur in an actual free society, because, well, we don't really have any examples to go on. Sure, there are historical examples of anarchic societies, but as I have posited many times before, comparing those instances to what could and will, hopefully will, occur in the present day is kind of an apples to oranges thing, because just with the advancements in technology alone, it's a whole new ball game, you know, especially with things like the advent of the internet and the ability to transfer information almost instantaneously, the ability for the average individual to have much of the world's knowledge at their fingertips. It's completely different than what happened before, because people can find out about the misdeeds of government a lot more quickly. They can find out about potential threats a lot more quickly. So it's a whole new world. So those comparisons really aren't fair. But it is a reasonable question to ask, well, what would happen? Because there are realistic fears of people that have grown up knowing nothing but government and who have been led to believe that the idea of anarchy necessarily means chaos, necessarily would mean what they depict in stuff like Mad Max. You know, anyone who has actually studied these philosophies knows that's not actually true, but the average individual just goes on what they've been told and they believe the Hollywood version. So it's a legitimate question to ask what would happen, you know, what are some possible solutions. So I'd like to get into some of that today. I think to start, the best thing you as an individual can do is change your mindset. That is the first and foremost thing that must be done. You must be able to look at the situation as objectively as possible, try to apply logic to what you see, what you've been told, what you've been led to believe, and see if it pans out. And as I and my other co-host have discussed before, you know, when you get down to it, it's very easy to see the inherent contradictions in, say, the Constitution, when you're willing to take an objective look and not be blinded by what you have been force-fed through your indoctrination, and you take out the emotional appeals to, well, this is my country and my flag, and all of this silliness, this collectivizing rhetoric that so many people use without even thinking, which, as I think I've mentioned before, is always funny, especially when it comes from those that consider themselves to be on the right and claim to rail against socialism and communism and all these collectivizing ideas, but they sit around being a collectivist themselves. So the mindset needs to change first. You need to wrap your head around the fact that most of us have been force-fed a lot of lies. The government itself, any government, is not actually legitimate outside of the minds of the people who have been duped into thinking so. Because, especially in this particular country, you have the Declaration of Independence, which is looked upon as one of the founding documents and is of great importance. And if you take the words at face value, then even I would have to agree it's a pretty powerful document. You know, with all men being created equal and whatnot, and all that flowery language. Now, of course, I take some exception with it because it was written by Jefferson, who is lauded by many a statist, and even some voluntarists I know. But, you know, the guy writes about all men being created equal, meanwhile he still owns slaves. Doesn't seem to pan out. And, you know, I get people, even people close to me, who try to defend him and use the, well, it was, you know, it was a different time. Pretty much the, well, everybody else was doing it. Which, you know, is pretty laughable when you think about it, but most of these people say it very earnestly and believe that, well, it was part of the culture. Well, while that may be true, you're stripping him of all moral agency if you say, well, he did it because others were, or it was acceptable at the time. And I don't think he could do that. I think he was, you know, he wrote those words and he supposedly meant it, but then he still went around owning people. So that doesn't add up. But like I said, if you take it at face value, it was a great leap forward in the thinking of how individuals should be governed. Then the Constitution came along and contradicted much of that. I think I've pointed out before, you know, Article 1, Section 8 literally creates and codifies the ruling class by dictating that Congress shall have the power to, yada, yada, yada. And as we've discussed before, where'd they get this power? On what authority? How do they suddenly have rights that the average individual does not? So this completely contradicts the notion of all men are created equal. Because obviously if some men can have certain rights that others can't, they're not equal. So you need to wrap your head around stuff like that. Then when you reach that point, the next step is, well, what do we do now? You can try fighting the system from within the system, as many a libertarian or now even anarchist, with people like, you know, Jeff Berwick and the like, trying to run for office in Canada. You have Darryl W. Perry here in the States running in 2016 for president. I believe he's running on a dissolution of the government platform, which is also Adam Kokesh's plan for 2020. So there's that option. I'm not particularly fond of that option. I don't think you can really correct the system from inside the system. But if you're using an avenue like that for purely educational purposes, just to get the message out there, then I don't really see the harm in it, as long as you are not actually voting for anyone who is trying to run your life. But what can people do on the individual level? Well, there's lots of things you can do. Me, for instance, as of the beginning of this past year, I started taking my small business in a more agorist direction. I have pulled myself out of the banking system as much as humanly possible at this point. Once I rectify the mistake I made by getting a mortgage, I'll be able to take myself out of the banks altogether. But I started taking payments in other methods rather than check or credit card or cash. I mean, obviously, most of my clients still deal in FRNs, so I have to take those for the time being, but I've tried to steer most of my clients in other directions. I offer the possibility of payment in precious metals like gold and silver, Bitcoin. Some of my clients choose to pay me in Amazon or Visa gift cards. And I also offer barter as a possible solution. And a few clients have actually taken me up on that. Barter, I think, is a wonderful way to start disassociating yourself from the system. Barter in general is a pretty nifty way to exchange value with people. It doesn't necessarily work on the large scale, which is why the idea of money was eventually introduced, because it made transactions easier. Because if you live in a small community and you have a specified service or business, you know, say you're the guy who has chickens, so you're going to provide eggs and or meat for the people in your community. Some other guy likes to knit sweaters. You know, some other woman offers a clothes washing service. You know, any of these things. You can trade services for services. You can trade products for products. And in a small setting, this can work quite well. You do run into problems when you have, you know, say you have something, say you have some eggs to trade, but the guy with the sweaters has no need for eggs. Well, then you need to find a third party, or maybe a fourth party, so everybody can get what they want in order for the trade to be facilitated. So the more people that get involved, the more products and services can make barter a little more difficult and terribly time consuming. So that's where money, real money, not the fake fiat crap that most people carry in their pockets, but real money comes in handy. And, you know, money is just a medium of exchange, so it could be anything. You know, currently it's, most people think of money as the FRN notes they carry in their pocket. That's obviously fake money, but for now it's real enough to most people that you can still exchange it. Gold and silver can be real money. Anything really. I mean, way back in the day it was shells, and it was, you know, wheat and tobacco and pretty much anything that can be exchanged and agreed upon by a certain segment of the population can be used as money. So you can find quite a number of ways to still engage in trade, get the things you need, get some of the things you want, without just going the, you know, whipping out your credit card or your debit card, or relying only on FRNs. So that's a big step. You know, I encourage everybody to try to find ways to not use FRNs, and even more importantly, stay away from credit altogether, because debt, at least in the current system, just always ends up being a bad thing because people get in way over their heads, and then you're beholden to the system for even longer. So that's why I have, as I said, pulled myself out of the banking system as much as possible. I've gotten rid of all but one of my credit cards, and once that is finally paid down from the mistakes I made in the past, that will be gone too. Tied to that is also the business aspect. Starting your own business is a wonderful way to start opting out of the system. Now, depending on where you live and depending on what it is you want to do, there may be regulations, permits, licenses, all that bureaucratic BS that you may have to deal with, but it's not necessary. It's really a matter of what you are willing to put up with, what you are willing to risk, you know, knowing the possible repercussions of the state. You know, I got a good taste of this firsthand when, almost a year and a half ago now, I took part in a debate on the healthcare issue with Obamacare or the ACA or whatever you want to call it. A friend of mine was running a debate between a Tea Party guy who was, you know, hardcore anti-Obama, so therefore anti anything Obama did, and a more liberal individual who happened to be selling the insurance attached to Obamacare. So he was obviously pro the ACA, and I was asked to take part in the debate to give a libertarian slash anarchist perspective. And when I got up there to talk, I started mentioning that, you know, there's always ways around the system. It may make your life a little more difficult in the short term. You may have to go a little more out of your way, but there are ways around it. And the crowd, which was mostly conservative and Tea Party-ish, obviously was worried about not following the law. And I heard a lot of grumblings. And then I asked everybody, well, what is the problem? Are you really that afraid of what your government can do to you? And I got a resounding yes from the audience. And that's when it really hit me that it's not so much the government and the agents of the of said government that people like myself are up against. It's the fear of the citizenry and the horizontal enforcement that comes with that, where people are so afraid of what could happen to them that they will blindly rat on their neighbors for certain things because they don't want to be implicated. And I think it might be also a bit of jealousy, whether these people would want to admit it or not, but a bit of jealousy where you see somebody getting away, quote unquote, with something that you're not getting away with. So why should they be able to do that and you can't? Well, the reality is you can. You just don't think you can, or you're choosing not to. It's kind of like, you know, younger siblings who run and tattle to mom and dad because their older brother or sister is doing things that they were told not to do, and they were following the rules, and, well, it's not fair, Bobby's doing this. It's childish when you think about it, but that's the attitude. So it's that fear that keeps people from doing this, these things, you know? Plenty of people, I'm sure, have thought about starting their own business, even something small, even something part-time that's almost like a hobby. But if it's something that interests you and you can turn even a little bit of a profit on it, it seems like a wonderful opportunity. But so many people will reach that point and then realize that there's regulations against that, or you have to follow all, you know, have to jump through all these hoops in order to be considered a legal business. And that scares a lot of people off, so they don't even try. But, you know, I mean, even myself, when I started my business, I checked with the town, the county. I read up on as much of the rules and regulations as I could because, well, I wanted to run a legitimate business and I didn't want the state breathing down my neck. And, I mean, heck, I was still a statist at that point, but I wanted to do everything by the book because that's what I thought I had to do. You know, I even created an LLC and filed all the paperwork and got all the proper insurance. Now, some of these things I would most likely have done or would do in the future in a free society, but then it would have been out of choice, not because I thought I had to. But this type of thing holds a lot of people back, you know, and it's unfortunate because there's so many people out there that are still hurting because the economy is still in the tank, thanks to it being run to the ground by the fascistic nature of government. And there's a lot of people struggling. And a lot of them have some talent that they are most likely not utilizing for fear of being taxed more or having, you know, not filing all the proper paperwork and then later having to deal with the government goons coming and harassing them. And it's that fear that keeps them in place and doesn't let them advance. So my suggestion is forget about all that stuff. If you have something, some product or service that you can offer to the public that would be well received or even could possibly be well received, take a shot at it. You know, something that you make in your house or in your, you know, in your basement or your garage, or, you know, and something you've made that your friends see and say, hey, that's pretty cool, I'd like one of those, whatever it is. You know, we'll call it a widget for now. You know, you create this widget, your friends go, hey, that's really cool, I could use one of those. And, you know, you may give it to a couple of your friends, but if enough people see it and go, hey, I like that widget, I could use one of those widgets, well then, you start figuring out what people would be willing to pay for said widget, start selling it, you know? And something like this, something that simple, if you can put that fear of what could happen to you if the government found out that you weren't following all of their rules, you know, if you can put that out of your head, you can not only hopefully make a few bucks, but you may inspire somebody else to do something similar. Whether it's taking your widget and improving upon it, or altering it to make it do something slightly different, or starting their own business and making their own different widget. You know, this is how you build an economy. This is how you would build a society outside of the realm of government. People coming together, figuring out what it is they're good at, figuring out what it is they enjoy doing, combining that, and then figuring out what everybody else around them needs. And, you know, that's how the division of labor starts, where, you know, you enjoy raising chickens and then collecting their eggs and maybe slaughtering them when necessary so people have stuff to eat. That's your thing? Great, go for it. You know, you enjoy knitting or sewing, making clothes, people need clothes, go for it. You know, the widget example, whatever it is, you enjoy making that, do it. You know, the more people that start doing this and stop worrying about what could happen to them and just focus on how they can help the people around them, what they can do to benefit their friends and family and neighbors, and turn a profit in the process, because well, people need to live, people need to eat, so profit, despite what the socialist and the communist will tell you, is not necessarily a bad thing. Without it, there's a lot less incentive for people to do things. But the more people that start doing this, the more that other people will see this being done and say, hey, maybe I could do that. And then there becomes even more people that are less dependent on government, and even more people that are helping improve not only their situation, but the situation of those around them. And, you know, all these little steps can and hopefully will lead more people to realize, well, we don't actually need government for these things. You know, so-and-so is over here, started a little haircutting business in his garage. He doesn't have those, you know, fancy permits, but he does a heck of a job and charges a really competitive price. I'll keep going to him, you know? So something like, you know, starting your own business, like I said, whatever it is, forget about the rules and regulations. If you're not harming anybody, if you were doing so in a simple attempt to make yourself some money and do so honestly, then you are not initiating aggression against anyone. And the only people you are pissing off are the government, who are not getting their cut anymore, and the busybodies who think that the government needs to rule over everybody. Well, they're a bunch of immoral tools anyway, so who cares what they think? So I think starting your own business is a wonderful step. You know, it can also get people out of the corporate grind if they feel they're stuck there, because as we inch closer and closer to a potentially free society, corporations as we know them won't exist anymore, because corporations are a legal fiction. And they are created and perpetuated through the guns of government, you know, through special regulations and tax breaks and whatever. So they won't exist in the form we know them. I mean, there may and probably will still be big businesses, but it won't be the corporate system that we know today. So why not get a head start and get yourself out of that system? Find something else you can do. Find something else you're more suited to do. Find something to do that makes you happier. Another thing you can do is to either limit or completely eradicate your tax footprint. I know a lot of people who have tried to go the route, or somewhat of a similar route to, say, something Larkin Rose did about 15 years or so ago, which unfortunately landed him in prison for a year. But I know a lot of people who have tried to fight it on the terms that, well, I'm not, you know, income isn't supposed to be taxable, or the way the code reads is only certain things are taxable, and you know, other people try to gain the system, report less than they bring in. You know, me, I just decided to say, I'm not being extorted anymore. Simple as that. Now, is there risks involved with that? Sure. Is everybody up for that challenge? Of course not. But I have said for a very long time that stuff like this, all it would take was a few million people to just start saying, no, sorry, not gonna play your game anymore. And that end of the system will start collapsing on its own, because a few million people is more than the IRS has on staff. And they can't possibly go after everybody. And they wouldn't even try. That's why they try to make a big scene with some of the, you know, more famous people. You know, Wesley Snipes got nailed for tax evasion. It was made a big deal because they try to make an example of people like him. Even Larkin, who wasn't very well known at the time, but in the stateless society circles he was, you know, he was held up to be an example of what could happen if you fight the beast. So there are risks involved, but you have to make these decisions for yourself. You have to decide what it is you're, not only what you're willing to risk, but what you're willing to put up with. Because that's the other side of that. You know, sure, is there some risk in challenging the federal Leviathan? Absolutely. But I think it's a much greater risk to not challenge them, because that just keeps the status quo going. And that has not been very good for most people. So just simply opting out and saying, yeah, I'm just not going to do this anymore. You know, it may take a little more cojones than some people may think they have, but I got to tell you, at least from my perspective, it's rather liberating to do so. And, you know, just say, I will be as free as I can possibly be. I will not allow myself to be extorted, and I'm just gonna live my life. So that's another good step. You know, like I said, it's not for everybody, but the reality is, you know, a lot of people will say, oh, you're not paying your fair share. But paying my fair share of what? I rarely ever leave the state of New York, or as I like to refer to it, the People's Republic of New York. And most of the stuff I do is centered around the People's Republic of New York. The services I use are all paid through my property taxes, which I have no choice in paying currently because of the aforementioned mortgage I got myself into. And the fact that even though people think they own their property, when they purchase it, you don't actually own it because of eminent domain. The government can take your property at any time as long as they deem it necessary. And if you fail to pay your property taxes, you will also be threatened with having your house taken from you. So if someone holds a higher claim on your property than you, you don't actually own that property. The person who has the higher claim does. That's part of what makes the whole system really screwed up, because people go around buying houses, you know, taking out mortgages or even paying outright. But even once they pay off the mortgage and they think they own the house, if you are still required to pay property taxes, it means you don't actually own the house. And even if you can manage to get away from the property taxes, if that property falls within the jurisdiction of what the U.S. government claims as theirs, then eminent domain applies. And again, they can take it whenever they deem necessary. And as with most things with government, they're the ones who decide what is necessary. This is why I also encourage people to consider getting out of their mortgage if they have one. You know, there's lots of other options. You can rent. You can live with somebody else if you know, if that's an option for you. Or something I'm a big fan of is the tiny house movement. I haven't exactly been able to convince my wife on this yet, especially with our two little, well, as of today, they're being terrors again, but our two little ones, it'd be a little tight, but I think we could pull it off. I still have to sell her on that idea, but the idea in general, I think, is wonderful. You know, people are out there building these small little domiciles that, you know, I think there's even like one of those House Hunter shows or one of those type of reality shows that actually focuses on, or at least focused a few of them on, tiny houses. And you can see the amazing things people could do with these little spaces, you know, and a lot of them are small enough that they can actually be kept on a trailer, and then you can move them around as necessary. And that means no property taxes, which means you can actually own what you think you own. So that's another idea that I encourage people to look into. You know, a lot of people are used to the space they have. They like having a lot of space. I mean, we have a tiny house, a relatively tiny house right now compared to some other people. And it's nice to have space. It's nice to be able to have things, places to put your stuff. But with all the other baggage that comes with it, it's not exactly a winning scenario all the time. So I would definitely encourage people to look at that option too. And again, if you have a mortgage, I would highly suggest that you consider getting out of it. Or even if you own property already, again, you know, you don't have to take my word for it. Look into eminent domain. Look into what property taxes actually mean and what happens if you don't pay your property taxes. Because again, if they can take it from you based on their decisions, you don't actually own it. So, you know, I've covered a few things here. Ways you can help opt yourself out of the state. I really think that the more people that do this, the quicker the system will collapse. It's already in its death throes. That's really not that hard to discern. You know, you just look through history and you look at the mighty empires as they existed and as they started falling. And the tyranny always ramped up towards the end, because those in power realized that that power was slipping, because more and more people were rejecting that power. I can only hope that it doesn't come to a violent revolution, because history also shows us that that usually ends up badly. Even for the people who supposedly win, because the state they take down is just quickly replaced by another one, and the same problems start all up again. So I would much prefer to see individuals opting out as much as possible and ramping up the panic of the ruling class, but just continue to reject their efforts. You know, like I said earlier, it's there's risk involved. You know, in order to take on some of this stuff, you have to be willing to deal with some of the consequences that may come your way. And that can be very scary for a lot of people to even consider. And it used to scare the heck out of me. And a lot of people in my life tell me it still should scare the heck out of me, that I should, you know, I should put my family first, and I should worry about them. And I do worry about them. But for me, sitting back and not taking some of these risks because of my family just seems a little selfish, especially because I really do believe in my heart of hearts that a free society is the best hope for humanity, and I want to be able to do everything in my power to help that along. Obviously, I don't want to end up dead. I don't want to end up in a cage. But I also want to be able to look my children in the eye. You know, they're still little right now, and they're only starting to understand some of the things that I tell them on a regular basis. But I want to be able to look them in the eye as they get older and tell them that their daddy did everything he possibly could to make sure that they had a freer world than what he was given. You know, I don't want to look back later in life with regrets and say, oh, I could have done this and I could have done more. You know, because hoping that other people are going to take care of it for you is a lazy way out. So I take a lot of these risks. I buck the system. You know, I've talked about this before. I'm constantly challenging the traffic laws around here in my area. I'm battling with them on a regular basis. And just not taking things lying down like so many people do. You know, a lot of people don't want to deal with the hassle. And I understand that. I was like that for a very long time. But like I said, you're just trying to pass the buck off on somebody else. You're hoping somebody else will take care of the problem. And all any of us can really do is what we individually can do. So if you want to see a free society, you're going to have to stick your neck out a little bit. You know, maybe not as much as others. You don't have to go as far as me. And please, there's people that take it even farther than I do. And I applaud them. It takes some real cojones to stand up to the state a lot of the times, because you know what you're risking. You know, we see the stories all the time about, you know, law enforcement officers just killing people for disobeying their orders, even though they weren't actually doing anything wrong in the first place. But those people that stand up, some people will look at them and say, oh, they just wasted their potential. And you know, I hear a lot of people say, well, it's better to be out than be in the ground or be in a cage. Well, yeah, on the whole, you could probably do more damage if you're on the outside. But there needs to be people that are willing to take these risks, that are willing to show others the way, because that's the most important thing. It's not just about fighting the system. It's not about giving the middle finger to government. It's not about sticking your neck out there for any kind of accolades. It is a matter of being able to show others that it is possible to live outside the system, that it is possible to be successful without using the system. It is possible to create a business, a successful business, and stay outside the system. Other people need to see this, so we will no longer be asked the question, well, what are you going to do about it? Or we will never be told again, well, you're not offering any solutions. Well, here I am. I'm offering some solutions. They may not be what you want to hear. They may not even be what you would even consider doing, but they're possible solutions. And another thing you can do to help out this type of cause is to not only do it yourself, but help support people that are already doing it. Find somebody in your local community who's willing to work outside the system with their business. Help support them. Find some people that are involved in agorism. Help support them. You know, if just like we talk about on the Seeds of Liberty, you know, when at the end of our shows, when Danilo and Dave like to ask for some donations, and I will usually chime in and say, you know, you could just share our stuff. We don't even, you know, money would be nice, but just sharing what we have to say to others, so others may have the opportunity to see it. It's the same principle. If you're so terrified of what could happen to you and you're so afraid of the possible repercussions that you cannot bring yourself to do some of these things, well, at the very least, try to support those that are willing to do it. You know, share their message. Get it out there. Let other people know that there are those among us that are not only willing to buck the system, but do it for the right reasons. We are doing the, you know, people like myself, I'm doing this more for my kids and the next generations than I am for myself, because I don't expect to see the full-scale change in my lifetime, and I'm okay with that. But like I said, I need to be able to look my kids in the eye and tell them that I did everything I possibly can. So that is what I'm going to continue to do. And I can only hope that there'll be more out there that'll join me. So that's about all I got for this week. I think I ran kind of long with this one, but it's something I'm very passionate about. I really want to give my kids the freest possible world I can. And if that means I got to put my neck on the line on a daily basis to do so, well, that's what I have to do. So thanks everybody for watching. This has been Jeremy from the Seeds of Liberty podcast with another installment of Abolitionist Abstractions. And I'll see you next time. Peace.